完全是义务的，我没有拿任何薪水，因为我认为这是我对国家的责任。那从我毕业到现在，1997年从研究所毕业，到现在18年，他都做了同样的这样子，就是义务独立运动、非独立运动的工作。那他其他时间他就用来写诗、写评论、写散文，然后他把这些他的作品收集起来。自己手工做成书来卖，那这些卖书的收入就是他唯一的收入的来源。那虽然他是生活看起来是很贫穷的这个形式，但是呢，正因为这种生活这种需求欲望降到最低，这个反而是他力量的来源。他全身上下他只有两套。上衣跟牛仔裤，他每天就是穿同样的衣服简单的生活使得他能够专注，把他的力量专注在他想做的事情，同时也让他有一个非常鲜明的形象。
So when I say that I draw my strength from my religious practice, very different topics. I don't do it with monastery, say prayers, or do the prostration, or sit in front of Buddha and do like that. I don't do any of those. All these rituals, I complete the work. For me, Buddhism is really to go out from yourself to the outside. And try practicing selflessness. That what you're doing is not for you, but for others. But this sounds like a charity. In fact, when you travel from your selfishness to the outside and go for others, you will understand other people's problems in the way you understand your own problems. And therefore, even though we are under Chinese occupation, we actually understand the Chinese people's anger and hatred much more than they understand our problems. When China invaded Tibet, even today in the year 2012, when the whole of Tibet is under Chinese occupation, when Chinese military, police, intelligence, the government, the law, and the market economy is ruling over, sitting on the people's head. When the Chinese security forces are shooting Tibetan nomads and monks and nuns and students, instead of fighting back with anger or with guns, the Tibetans say prayers. The Tibetans come out into the street, raise their empty fist like this and say, we want freedom and we want the Dalai Lama back to Tibet. And when the Chinese security forces are shooting at them, they take the bullets in the chest. That is it. This is the unique power that we are talking about in the front. And it is important for the world that this unique power does not fail. The struggle, the non-violent struggle that the Dalai Lama is leading today must not fail for the world. Because globally, there is state terrorism, there is market economy which is ruling over everybody to make everybody greedy. This trend is going on. And in this space, the last voice of humanity is that of the struggle that His Holiness the Dalai Lama is leading. And that we also see that in the form of Aung San Suu Kyi's Burmese movement. So there are very, very few genuine cases of humanity living, and we must not let it fail. If these fail, then tomorrow people will say that nonviolence is now not radical, that nonviolence will never pass, that nonviolence will never succeed. That is important. But the world is still to make that decision. There is still hope. And therefore, the Tibetan struggle is not just Tibetan problem. It's not just Chinese Tibetan problem. This is a hope for the world.
最重要的力量的来源是来自于宗教，也就是藏传的佛教。但是他信仰佛教的方式，他不是很根据佛堂，或者去转经文，或打坐等等。他认为佛教是一种发自内心的，特别重要的是在于怎么样去降低自我，对，怎么样去。做任何事情都先想到别人，而不是自己。那通过这样的过程，我们更能了解到别人的困难，会设身处地为别人着想。但是同样的，这样也能够让我们更加了解自己，因为我们都是同样的人类。所以呢，也因为图博人这样子有宗教的观点，所以使他们也更能了解到，他们不是唯一的受害者。事实上，中国人虽然压迫他们的这个另外一个民族，同样也是受害者。所以，当中国的用这些军警的暴力来镇压他们的时候呢，他们可以舍弃用愤怒或是用暴力的方式去反击，而是坚持用一种和平的方式啊，甚至不惜迎向子弹啊，牺牲自己，或者是用自焚的方式来表达抗议。那事实上正是读国的这个独立运动它的独特的力量所在。那他认为对全世界都很重要的一点是，这样一种达赖喇嘛所领导的非暴力的抗争的运动呢，必须要让它成功而不是失败。否则的话，因为读国的运动就像少数其他的像翁山书记领导的缅甸的反抗运动一样，是世界上少数不断的坚持非暴力的方式去抵抗强权的这样一种运动。如果他这样子的运动让他被强权击败的话呢，那就好像证明了非暴力是没有用的，好像证明我们人类的文明是错误的。所以说他认为图国的这一场抗争，他并不是光为了图国人民、图国一个民族，而是为了全世界。
But it doesn't mean that all the Tibetans are peaceful and non-violent and good kind of smiling Tibetans all the time. Many of us get in. Especially, it is frustrating. It's frustrating to be in this position where internationally everybody knows that Tibet was occupied. Everybody knows that Tibet was once an independent country. America, United Kingdom, India, Germany, India, everybody knows that Tibet was once an independent country. In fact, with United Kingdom, with today's Great Britain, United Kingdom, with that country we even had trade relations. We had international relations with it. And India was born in 1947. Right up to 1949, we were independent. Everybody knows. And still, because China has military power, and today, because of China's money, everybody is keeping silent. And the maximum they say, oh, there is a problem between the Tibetans. Very frustrating to know this. And it seems that there is no sense of justice and human rights and peace and harmony that everybody loves to talk about in peace conferences. It's all bullshit. It's nothing there. In reality, it's not there. All the countries are lying in front of everybody. It's frustrating to know this. But again, it is this our spiritual practice that gives us a power to say, to understand the smallness of these countries' selfishness. When America is lying, it is their smallness. It's America's smallness that America is lying in front of everybody. And everybody knows. So why should we lose our sleep in the night? It is their smallness. If they're lying, it is their problem. And that kind of understanding is what comes to us with our spiritual. When I went to Tibet, when I was arrested and being there in prison, in Tibet, when I used to get beaten up by the Chinese police, of course, I was very angry, I was very afraid in the jail. There was a time when I was in jail that I didn't know when I was going to be free, or that I may be killed the next day. Because when I went into Tibet, I did not tell anybody that I was going into Tibet. So when I got arrested, when I was in jail in Tibet, nobody in the world outside knew that I had gone inside and that I was arrested. So if I was killed inside, nobody would know. I would be finished. And therefore I was really afraid. And that is my situation, where somebody who is born outside Tibet had gone in and seen the situation. And what about those Tibetans who get arrested, beaten up, tortured, and they die in prison, and their bodies are never handed over to their parents, they vanish forever. And these people have never seen the freedom, democracy, in the outside world. And they continue to live. That is a unique power. We are 6 million Tibetans. China is 1.3 billion population. But our concerns are never about China's money, China's guns, China's population. In fact, we believe that China is a big country, global population. China must remain prosperous. China must remain big and rich country, but only as our neighbor. As we have always lived as neighbors for the past all these thousands of years. We live as neighbors. We have mutual respect. We respect their culture. They must respect us. So we are not against China or Chinese people. In fact, many of Tibetan religious arts, cultures have influences of Chinese culture. And Chinese culture has also remnants of Tibetan idea and thinking. It's also there. Because we have lived as neighbors. And because we do not hate them, the Chinese government, through its rigorous process of propaganda, has been teaching, raising the younger generation of Chinese with this propaganda that Tibetans are barbaric people, they have no sense of culture, they are dirty people, they used to have feudal society, aristocratic feudal society. Today we have developed the Tibetans. Today Tibetans are grateful to China motherland. And when Tibetans protested, the Chinese government even credits to their population that Tibetans are ungrateful to the motherland. Therefore we think that China's anger is the one that is controlling the Chinese. They may have physically, by military and police, they may have colonized Tibet. But the colonization is reversed. We may be physically, militarily colonized, but they are colonized because of their anger, because of their own propaganda. They are possessed. They are angry all the time. And we are free. In deep in our hearts.
并不是说所有的中国人每一个都是爱好本品都是很可爱的。事实上全世界都知道中国是被占领的，中国过去是一个独立的国家。这个是全世界包括美国英国都知道的事实，甚至于英国还曾经跟达赖喇嘛政府签订国际贸易条约，印度尼泊尔也都跟中国签订过条约。但是今天是因为中国有了钱，所以世界各国忽然都装成好像不知道，他们都变得非常伪善。那即使如此呢，我们吐蕃人仍然不会害怕，因为我们有坚强的精神的信仰。那我们认为说美国英国他们今天说谎不承认我们过去的独立的事实，这是他们自己失去他们的国别而不会改变这个事实。那事实上我自己也曾经入狱，因为他在1997年从研究所毕业之后呢，他第一件事情他就一个人徒步翻越喜马拉雅山回到中国境内，想要去境内去了解真实的状况。那但是呢，他在进去的时候呢就被逮捕，曾经被关在拉萨的监狱长达3个月。那他说他在这段期间以后也曾经被中国警察殴打，那当时他也会感到愤怒，他甚至也非常害怕，因为他不知道他会不会被放出去，甚至于他可能明天就会被处决因为当时他一个人进去的时候他没有告诉任何人，所以没有人，全世界没有人知道他被关在哪里。所以呢，他就算中国把他杀掉也不会有人晓得这件事情。那所以在这个情况之下，他当然也会感到非常害怕。那他其实对他来讲，这是他自己愿意去承担的，而且是他已经长大了，他这个成人之后他自己做的一个决定。但是对于在吐蕃境内那些从小就生活在不自由的环境里的，从小就失去自由，甚至于可能随时都会失去生命这样子的同胞来说，他们当然更会感到愤怒，感到害怕。但是呢，他们还是能够坚持下来，因为他们有这样子佛教的这样子宗教的精神力量。那所以呢，虽然吐蕃人只有600万，那中国人有13亿，但是呢，他认为吐蕃的文化这样一种宗教的文化是无与伦比的，所以因为他们并不是羡慕或是嫉妒中国的资源，或是他们的军事的力量跟他们的国际的地位，他们都不羡慕，他只是希望能够跟中国恢复到一个好邻居的关系。那正因为他们没有欲望，所以他们也不会仇恨，所以在这种情况下，相对来说他们反而是自由的那一方。虽然他们的身体受到控制，但他们的精神是自由的。因为中国人一再的为了控制吐蕃呢，他们一再的用宣传去教导中国的人民说这个西藏吐蕃是如何的封建落后，是一个野蛮的社会，那他们的进步都是中国人的恩惠那反而是他们中国政府认为说这个吐蕃人是不知道感恩图报那他们反而是自己用这些仇恨的，用这种错误的虚假的说法来绑住他们自己所以虽然说中国用